Hello!
And welcome to PostFeature, the premiere film review show.
I'm here with my favourite jumper. How are you, Jessica?
Your favourite jumper?
Yes, this jumper. Because I wear it a lot, don't I? We came to this realisation before we started, didn't we? I wear this jumper a lot. I need a wardrobe, don't I? That's what I need. I need a wardrobe.
We have some issues.
It's exciting.
Even a shirt. I'd be happy with a shirt.
A shirt? Something with a collar.
I might buy you a shirt.
Something with a collar? Could be good, couldn't it?
I'll buy you one for your birthday.
That'd be nice. Smarten me up a bit, eh? Might have a shave next time too.
We can but dream.
Might comb my hair.
We can but dream.
What's happening in today's show?
In today's show, we are going to be looking at Insurgent. Which is the next in the Divergent series.
Divergent.
It's actually the middle of what should be a trilogy because there are three books, but they're going to do that annoying thing where they split the final book in two.
They're going to do that thing.
Yep. We'll also have a classical review, which we're looking at Fahrenheit 451.
451, that's hot.
It's the point at which books burn.
Ah.
And in the second half, we'll be looking at...
Is it Cinderella?
Yes.
I say it weird because it's just Cinderella, isn't it? It just makes it weird.
No, it's like a live-action version of Cinderella.
Ah, okay.
So apparently it's slightly different, although we'll see.
Yes. I've got a trailer to show as well, actually.
Yes, you do.
Hey. But first up... It's Insurgent.
You found it. What is in that box?
I don't know, but this is the only chance we have to rescue a little civilization we have left.
Let's begin.
Janine's never gonna stop coming after us.
Go!
Find every last one of them.
It's time we fight back.
Dark times call for extreme measures.
I can't let anyone else die because of me.
Help me!
Insurgent. In cinemas March 19th. Book tickets now.
So there we go. That was Insurgent, the second of the Divergent series, all about a dystopian world where people have been split into five factions. And if you don't fit into a faction, you are divergent.
And if you want help, watch The Hunger Games to understand what this film's about.
Yeah, which isn't at all like this film. And isn't at all based on a young adult series.
I'm a bit tired. The film's all right.
I've got to say, I very much enjoyed the first one.
I thought the first one's good.
Divergent was really good.
This one's all right.
This one, it doesn't have that awful middle film syndrome.
No.
Where, you know, you kind of think, but why was there no beginning to this film? Why is there no end? Why did I watch this film? Instead, it does have quite a good end, so you could watch these two films together and be like, oh, I'm done.
Yeah, it did make sense. Yes. The beginning, a middle, and an end, which
was
nice.
My God, this film, and I don't want to sound prejudiced.
But she's going to anyway.
Or wrong. But why the hair?
Yeah.
Why?
See, the thing is, because we know that old Charlene... She did the old Fault in the Stars,
yeah,
where she
did,
cut
where
her hair.
She had to cut off her hair, and she chose not to wear a wig or have extensions put in for this film.
What I understand, though, is in the books, she does cut her hair, but not as short as that.
Slightly. She cuts her hair slightly. It's not like she goes... Also, that is a really styled short haircut, which she has done with some rusty scissors in front of a mirror.
Yes, indeed.
I think so.
Well, I know. What I seem to know, I don't know about you, but it seemed like her hair like changed slightly in every scene, every shot.
Yes. And sometimes it was like this.
It kept changing.
It was just really bad.
Yeah.
But she's such a good actress.
Yeah, she is good.
I think Shelley Woodley's actually a very good actress.
She is.
And I was watching her on screen, like, if I could just do this to you.
Just
and be looking
just
at just
hair.
The face. I would really appreciate this scene. And I'd be really touched by it.
It is the story of, you know, love conquers all in a way, isn't it? The same old thing you see with Theo James, or Thor, as he is known. We do have a little...
He is his own person.
Yes, absolutely. We do have a clip to show, don't we? We have a clip of lots of running, and Kai Courtney is in this clip. By the way, 5 days difference between the first film and the second film, Kai Courtney's hair came back on the side of his head in 5 days. Absolutely amazing how that happened.
What is the hair in this film?
And Kai Courtney doing a fantastic T-1000 impression, I think, in this particular scene. So let's have a look.
Keep going. Come on.
Yeah.
There we go. That's a little clip there from Insurgent. And an example of, there are some exhilarating moments.
Yes.
Edge of your seat stuff.
There are. However, the first film wasn't really that violent.
No.
If you think about it.
No, not compared to this one.
Not compared to this one, where they seem to casually murder people quite a lot.
A lot of killing.
They get on the train. I'm not spoiling it. They get on the train. There are some people on the train. They must fight the people on the train. Now, at various moments, each character has a little breakdown about, oh God, I killed so-and-so. Oh God, my tragic actions led to the tragic death of this tragic person. But the people they fight on the train, they throw off the train under the train. Those people are dead, okay? They are squished by a train. Does anyone care? No.
No, definitely not.
No one even comments.
No. And I, whilst I say this film is good, I am a little tired of children pretending to be adults. The whole, you know, the Hunger Games and the Maze Runner. Well, the films are good, it's just like, come on, these are children.
I think they're adults pretending to be teenagers.
Yes, teenagers, children. You know.
Can we start casting teenagers?
Yeah.
As actual teenagers?
Yeah, might be. Because Theo James has got to be in his 30s. He's playing like an early 20-year-old.
It looks a bit wrong.
Yeah, it's not right. Now, have you got, you've got your classical review now, haven't you?
I do.
It's a hot one.
I do.
It's a hot one.
It's also set in a dystopian universe. And I have picked it because it was my favourite book when I was about 8. It's Fahrenheit 451. Fahrenheit 451, filmed in 1966 but set in a dystopian future, is based on a novel by Ray Bradbury and directed by French master of cinema, François Truffaut. Guy Montag is a firefighter who lives in a lonely, isolated society where books have been outlawed by a government fearing an independent thinking public. But these are not the firefighters we are used to. Rather than putting out fires, it's their job to find and burn on sight any books, including the illegal collections that have been reported by suspicious informants. In this society, people are drugged into complacency, getting their information from wall-length television screens and becoming completely illiterate. Montag falls in love with book-hoarding Clarice and begins to read confiscated books. Through this relationship, he begins to question the government's motives behind book burning and, when found out, must decide whether to repent and return to his job or go on the run. The movie's opening credits are spoken rather than displayed in type, which might be the director's hint of what life would be like in an illiterate culture. Director Truffaut's stamp is all over the film, although he wasn't happy with it, and it's likely that his remarks about the film are responsible for its unfairly low reputation. It became his white whale, taking 4 years just to put the production together. Filming took place in Great Britain, and the shoot for Fahrenheit 451 proved difficult for Truffaut, in part because he spoke no English. A wonderful start for filming an English language film. But largely because working with his lead actor, Oscar Werner, proved all but impossible. Rather than keeping their conflict out of the press, Truffaut decided to break the story himself, publishing excerpts from his diary about their conflict in Cahiers du Cinéma. The account told of a difficult and unpleasant experience filming with Werner, including Truffaut's shock when his actor arrived on set one day towards the end of the shoot with an entirely new haircut, which then needed to be masked in post-production for the sake of continuity. Truffaut was no doubt not entirely blameless in this, and he is certainly his own worst publicist. It is a shame, however, as whilst Fahrenheit 451 is a drastic change from the director, being his first colour film, and the only one in the English language, which makes complete sense considering he spoke no English, colour brings a new creative dimension to Truffaut's work, and the world of science fiction allows abstractions that weren't found in his earlier work, both visual and intellectual. So there you go, that's Fahrenheit 451. Did that inspire you to read a book, Joseph Gunn?
Yes.
Is that a lie, Joseph Gunn?
Yes.
Will you at least attempt to watch the film, Joseph Gunn?
Yes.
Oh, good.
I like fire.
Right, join us after the break when we will be discussing Cinderella, and Joseph has a brand new trailer for us.
Wait and see what it is, though. It's a secret. Oh. See you in a bit. Welcome back to
PostFeature. It's the best film review show on TV.
On the planet. Before the break, we were looking at Insurgent, weren't we?
Which is the second part of the Divergent series.
The Divergent series, absolutely.
With some bad hair.
With some bad hair.
Generally an okay film, but...
Yeah, it's all right.
Really
yeah.
distracting.
It's good for the kids. I forgot to say, actually, when I saw the film, there were a lot of teenagers in there. Teenage girls.
Yeah.
And they loved it. You know, they were screaming and stuff. And they were, yeah, they all loved it. They annoyed me just for making that much noise. But, you know...
Teenage girls, not really your thing.
You can't pick who is in the cinema with you, can you?
No. But if moving only. On to another film in which you will probably be bothered by both teenage girls and children.
Mmm.
Exciting. I think I should just take him to do this just for that, really.
Just for fun.
Just for funsies. Mm. It's Cinderella.
Cinderella.
The new live-action, updated Disney version of the classic.
And it's got a shoe in it.
Trailer.
Won't you tell me who you really are?
Remember, the magic will only last so long. The last stroke of midnight, the spell will be broken.
I suppose there hasn't been much to celebrate. Until now.
Find that girl.
So there we go. It's the live-action version of the original classic. And yeah. Of course, everyone knows the story. Don't pretend you don't.
It's about a shoe that gets lost, and the lovely prince finds it at the ball, and then he falls in love with her and thinks, I need to find this lady, because if the shoe fits, wear it. Next film.
Moving on. So... this new live-action updating of Cinderella, they're calling it an updating. Why? I don't see any difference. I've watched every single trailer that this thing has.
Yeah.
It's in live-action. What? No, I don't see anything new. I would like a new feminist Cinderella, please. Come on,
feminist
Disney.
Cinderella.
You've been doing so well. So well. I mean, we had Frozen, which, yes, you hate. But... Frozen, think about it. It's got some good values in there for women.
I don't want to think about it.
They choose each other over, like, men don't even factor into it. Also, she's a queen in her own right. She is a queen. She does not have to marry someone to become a queen. Wonderful. Also, Tangled, she's a princess and he is the pauper. It's pretty good.
Snow White.
The new updating Snow White.
I've just said it.
Do you mean?
I'm just trying to chime in with names.
Okay.
Does she not
the
count?
The live action version of Snow White.
Yes.
Which was it Snow White and the Huntsman?
Yes. I did see that. Yeah, that was good, actually. Yeah, that was all right.
Okay.
Because it was very different.
She gets to hold a sword and be her own strong, powerful woman.
Do you not see that for the Cinderella? Do you not see that happening?
Do you?
No. No.
I think she's a... pretty girl in a big dress who...
It's really blue, isn't it?
Falls in love with a... what?
The dress is really blue. Like, I've seen pictures of it and stuff, and, I mean, it's I think you can see it here, and it's, like, really blue. Like, it's the bluest thing I think I've ever seen. It's actually insane. Should we see a little clip where we can see this really, really blue dress?
I was wondering where that
swinging
was
swinging from side to side.
At you.
Believe me, they're all looking at you.
Fair enough, that's a very blue dress.
It's a very so blue dress. Blue!
Also, that was Lily James from Downton Abbey. Because the Americans are now obsessed with Downton Abbey, Harry Potter, and various other British things.
All of our stuff.
They really should be there. We are wonderful.
Yes.
So, yeah, okay, I'm getting that the people in it are all British and have wonderful accents. That makes sense. I don't really want to watch it, though. that much, except for Kate Blanchett.
Yes, Kate Blanchett is
an attraction. Kate Blanchett looks to be, in this, a rather wonderful, fearsome stepmother.
Helena Bonham Carter is in this as well, which is interesting. Because Tim Burton hasn't directed this film.
Shocker.
I don't think she's been in
anything
else.
Kenneth Branagh has, in fact, directed this film. Yeah. And it looks lovely. Good job.
It does look nice,
well done.
Yeah, it looks lovely.
But
really blue. Yeah.
I was expecting more. Mm. I was expecting an updating. I was expecting...
Guns.
Pizzazz. I wanted some pizzazz.
Pizzazz.
Although, we haven't seen it yet. We don't know. But from having seen the trailers, I do.
It looks the same, doesn't it? And what they've done, instead of drawing it, they've just put real people in it. It looks like the same story, doesn't it? Mm. Like, nothing's really changed.
But then, do you think it is Disney's job with updating their old films to add in values that are more appropriate for the modern day?
Absolutely. Yes, I completely agree.
What would you like to see?
Well, the thing, like you said, we mentioned Snow White and The Huntsman. That's a good example.
Mm.
Because, yes, it does more evaluate the ideals of everyday life today. I use a lot of words that I don't normally use. That's good. And I think, you know, things like Cinderella, because that's a good opportunity to do such things.
Mm-hmm. We can also pull Maleficent into this.
We can, yes.
Which is, of course, a live-action updating... / prequel of Sleeping Beauty.
Yes.
Not really about Sleeping Beauty, about Maleficent. But without spoiling that film, it is more to do with how she is misunderstood and how, as a woman, who is quite rightfully angry about some rather annoyingly not great things that have happened to her, really not great things, yes. Really not great, she's then been cast in the earlier film, as she would have been in the actual era, as a woman who is, hysterical and evil.
Mm.
Rather than just a rightfully upset woman.
Evil. An evil woman.
She's upset.
She's upset.
And that's okay.
That's okay. But there's another way. They're going to be doing Beauty and the Beast, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
They're doing a live-action version of that.
Involving Emma Watson.
Indeed, yes.
As Beauty.
Yes.
Which is a bit of an obvious choice.
Fills me with fear.
Why?
Because I just don't really rate her that much, to be honest.
Oh.
You know.
Joseph Gunn.
No one from Harry Potter, Alan Rickman, it's Alan Rickman. But no one from Harry Potter really, the younger cast has done much really, have they? Like, anything good. Daniel Radcliffe did Horns. Horns was good. I liked Horns.
I think one Woman in Black.
Woman in Black's good, but he didn't need him in it, really. It could have been anyone. It was such an easy role.
He does some really good stage work, though.
I haven't seen that. Doesn't he get naked in that? He gets naked on stage, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Apparently.
That's not the point. Move on. The point is... not the point. Move on. The point is that, yes, they are proving themselves as actors, and that's quite a struggle. I think they have the weight of expectation on them, whereas other young actors do not. Lily James.
Yes, absolutely.
Cinderella.
Yes, yes, indeed. But yeah, no, fair play. I'll let Emma Watson have a try at Beauty and the Beast. I've only seen Beauty and the Beast once. Is that bad? Like the cartoon?
I don't imagine so. Can you remember?
I can remember the idea of it. You
recall the entire film?
No.
Well, then watch the entire film again.
I was young. I was only a wee lad.
Watch the entire film again.
Maybe I need to.
Watch the whole thing.
I think I should. Do you think it's time that I play a little trailer now?
So you don't have to stop talking about girls in big dresses.
Yeah, it's right. So blue. This week's trailer of mine is a little bit different, and it has Adam Sandler in it. A hit and miss man, or a Marmite man, you might say. This film is Pixels.
Some alien life force has sent real life video games to attack us.
Pac-Man's a bad guy?
May I introduce to you the creator of Pac-Man?
Professor Iwatani, what are you doing?
I will talk to him. He's my son.
Hello, my sweet little boy. Look how big you've grown.
It's so sweet. He's so sweet.
And... Pixels! There you go. So, Old school computer games come to take over the world, including Space Invaders and Pac-Man.
And Donkey Kong. And this is in no way to make money from someone's back catalogue.
No.
Much the way that Etch-A-Sketch was going out of business until they were in Toy Story. And suddenly, boom.
Boom indeed. Adam Sandler's in this, as I say. Bit of a Marmite. Do you like Marmite?
I think we should stop casting Adam Sandler in things because it can ruin a film.
That means
should we
you
take
don't
that
like
chance? 50-50. It is 50-50.
He's done good stuff like a long time ago. He's done some good stuff. Happy Gilmore is a good film.
So you know what? If you did stuff
singer,
a while ago,
yes,
and now you're not doing good stuff, let it go. Move on.
Kevin James.
Don't
is
tell
in
me
this.
That man doesn't have money.
Kevin James is in this as well. Kevin James is good.
Okay.
And I think it could be a good film. I say watch it because it's a bit old school computer games.
We will see.
That's all
and
we've got
we
time
see
for.
See you next week.
Bye.